There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be wider, much wider than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in this life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Oh, there is stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain are all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. When I'm standing in your love, shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. There's power. You give life, you are love, you bring light into the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. You give life, you give life. Dark. give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our give life. You are love. You bring light into the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. Your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord, and all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. We'll shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
know it's a simple task, something everybody can do, I promise, not too challenging. Can you just breathe in and breathe out this morning? Can you do that? Just take a breath in, take a breath out. You know what that means? That means you're still here. Who's thankful to still be here? And all of us, all throughout this week, depending on the environment that you've been, with the mask on, we've had to breathe in and out. With the mask off, we've breathed in and out. How many of you know with the mask off, it's a lot easier? But in the challenge, we have been navigating it. You know what? As a county, as we're trying to figure it out and do our best right now, we are doing our best to think this morning about the very thing that God breathed into us in the very beginning of time, the bara, the breath, Hebrew word, the breath of God. And it was said of humanity that when he breathed in bara, only time he used it in this case, that he breathed in life, and in it was a body. There was a soul with that. It was an eternal being that would live forever and ever and ever. Who's thankful that you're that eternal being today? Who's thankful? Again, we're shouting it as a church. We're a pilgrim passing through. Let's just say in reality, in 100 years, I'm gone. Amen. But I'm going to be in a better place. I'm going to be with the Lord. And I'm just reminded of that as we have been able to gather in one service this morning. Man, we got a great crowd this morning back together as a family. It's been remarkable the different ways that we have just decided to worship the Lord. We've done that in the 9, the 10, 45. We have many that are watching online from home today. Can we just give a shout out? Can you put your hands together for all those that are watching online today? Both part of Meramec Heights Church and not part of Meramec Heights Church, thank you for being here this morning. We're just remembering today that it's in him that we live and move and have our being. And I'm most thankful for this. We do everything that we can to hold on to life. It's part of being human. It's part of what the Lord has put in us. But one day this guy right here is going to take his last breath. Who knows, every breath in your body has been counted by God. And when it's your time to go, you're going to go be with him. But today we have an opportunity. Brandon, I love this song that we're singing. We have an opportunity just with our breath to praise and worship the Lord. Can we go into that chorus again real quick again? It's your breath. Sing it with us, church.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour.
It is my hope as pastor of Meramec Heights Church, and I join in that today. It is my hope that this church would live out the Bible. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We are here to praise you. We are here to declare your goodness. We are here to be instructed in the faith today, encouraged in the faith, built up, God. Where we're broken, you'll heal us. Where we're sick, you will heal us. You will put us back together. We're thankful today for the teaching of your word. We're thankful today for the opportunity to give. And I just ask that your blessing would rest upon everything that is done today. And God, at the end of this service, this part of the day, that you would be glorified and that you would be exalted in all that we say, that we sing, that we give, that we do. In Jesus' name, and Meramec Heights Church shouted this morning, amen. Hey, can you turn around or look side to side this morning? Just invite or say hello to somebody, encourage someone. We're thankful that you're here. We're thankful for what the Lord is doing in you, in the local church, in your family. I don't even know. You know, at some point you kind of stop counting weeks. Sorry, we've got a little glitch. It's all right, Joshua. We'll just roll with whatever it is. We're not sure what it is. So if you hear that pop, just say praise the Lord. Okay. As we've regathered, we've had some hurdles that we're working through, and having some people kind of calibrate the system. So there might be some weeks that we're figuring things out. So be patient with us. Who, parent-wise, who's already navigated the first week of school, whatever that looks like for you? Anybody been through that? Anybody been back to a day or so? Regardless if you're going to Life Campus for part of meeting or all of your meetings for school or your home on whatever that looks like, these are some pretty challenging times to navigate. And we just wanted to say, as a church family, we're praying for you. Some of us in that very vein that you're in, and we're trusting the Lord. We wanted to just take a moment, and we're going to be doing something special for the kids after service today, as many of you know. But I want to take a moment, if we can get, just in our family groups right now, if we could get moms and dads that would be willing to stand with your kids for prayer this morning. We want to just pray over every family. And if you would do that with me, if you have your kids close, just gather them in for a moment. And I want to invite the church family just to extend your hands toward these beautiful, wonderful people, because I promise you they need encouragement. And let's pray together, because the prayers of a righteous man and woman availeth much. So this is going to help people even this week. As you sow a prayer today, it's going to help people. Father, I thank you for each and every family that is represented. I thank you for all the kids that are in the house today with mom and dad. I thank you for those that are watching online. Lord, we really do covet your help, and we need your help in this journey. Lord, we wholeheartedly work together in tandem under a spirit of unity. Lord, as we're working through things and figuring things out, Lord, I just pray that you would help us, God. I pray that you would direct us as families, Lord, as we're doing these studies with our kids, Lord, as we're navigating through this, as we're working with teachers, administrators, all of this, that we in our local cities would have a real spirit of unity, that we would work together, not work separately, but that we would just try to figure it out. And I also pray this, Lord, however we decide that things would look for our families, I pray that we would support one another, carry one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. So I just pray a very special blessing upon everyone that is here today, specifically on these families, God, that are getting the kids ready for school or already engaged in that. We need a lot of grace and a lot of mercy, Lord, so we're reaching out to you in Jesus' name. And everyone said this morning, amen. Hey, Joshua, let's just go ahead and mute this and turn the other mic on, if you don't mind, bud. Okay, we have with us a group of people that work in the field of education in a multiplicity of ways. We have some that teach. We have some that looked over the grounds of these educational institutions. We have some that work in the administration side of things, at admission, just trying to keep everything working and running. And we have a wonderful church that is praying for those individuals. But we wanted to take some time to recognize those individuals. We're not going to go in totality to what they do today, as we are broadcasting online and are just kind of keeping things a little bit more private with that. But we are going to be calling individuals up this morning and just presenting them with a gift. And then as a church, we're going to be praying over them. So we need your help when we get into those prayer times. I'm going to see if, Freddie, if you don't mind to come. Tracy, I think you're coming as well. And we've got a blue X for you to stand on over here, Freddie. Stay on the blue X, Freddie. How many of you appreciate Freddie? And we're thankful for the work that he does here in a region not too far away from Meramec Heights Church to help things happen on a particular campus here in this area. Do you mind to pray with me for Freddie today? Father, we just thank you for Freddie and we pray for an extra dose of wisdom and grace, specifically in the field that he's in, an extra dose of wisdom, the inner workings of things. I thank you that you put your hand upon him and that he is called to do exactly what he's doing. Now we pray that you would continue to go before him in Jesus' name. Amen. And then we have a gift over there from Meramec Heights Church for you, Freddie. Thanks so much. Justin is over here. Justin, if you would come this morning. We're thankful for Justin. Can we give a shout out to Justin this morning? I'm going to pray for Justin today. And the field that he's in has a variety of things that he does in the field of education, training, helping students to succeed. And we want to just pray over him this morning. So can you stretch your hands this way and then pray with me. Don't make me be the only one praying. Several collective prayers today. Holy Spirit will show you. Pray in your heavenly language, whatever the Lord shows you, but pray. Father, I thank you for Justin. I thank you for what you've called him to. I thank you too. I speak this over this man's life that you've called him for such a time as this, that the area of involvement that he has in education right now, Lord, the area of support, the area of encouragement that you have in him, it goes a long way. And we pray over Justin, and we pray just for a special grace, a special dose of wisdom as we prayed over Freddie. He that asks for wisdom will get it from you, Lord. I ask in Jesus' name that you would fill him with everything he needs to navigate the semester in front of him. We pray for those things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks so much, Justin. We got a gift over there for you. Kristen, she's over here. Go ahead and come, Kristen. We're going to pray for Kristen today, my sister. I think I can say that online, can't I? My sister. I'm thankful to have all my sisters attending the church that I pastor. That's always a pretty cool thing when you pastor it and they don't run off, you know. But we want to pray for Kristen today, and that many of you know what she does, where she does that. We want to pray God's special mercy over her during this time. Lord, thank you for Kristen, and I just thank you. We've got so many different personality types that stand up here. You have blessed her with a very upbeat and bubbly personality. I ask that during this time wherein what she does is very much needed, I speak this over Kristen. The joy of the Lord is her strength. And I pray, Lord, that in the dealings that she has within education, the different varieties that she'll meet with in different groups, I thank you that the joy of the Lord goes before her, even in challenging times. Watch over her, strengthen her, and give her exactly what she needs at exactly the right time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Appreciate you, Kristen. Got a gift for you. Kylie, come on up, Kylie. How many of you appreciate Kylie? And under normal circumstances here at the church, we don't really see Kylie up here because she would be working with our kids, but with us just making some changes to that for the time being, we're thankful that she's up here. We're thankful for what the Lord has called her to, and I think most of us would understand Kylie has a real passion and a love for kids, and we want to pray for Kylie today. So if you don't mind just to stretch your hands this way, let's pray over Kylie. Lord, I thank you for Kylie today, and I thank you that you too have put her exactly where you needed her to help model what it means to be a godly woman, God, in the function and then the role that you've given her. I thank you, Lord, that you are at work in her daily. I thank you that you are strengthening her. I thank you that you are helping her with the challenges of this season. Even as we have sang these songs today, I pray that it would encourage and build Kylie up, Father, that as she shows up for work the next day that she works, that you're going to watch over her, that you're going to go before her, and that people are going to be able to look to her and at her and says she navigates the times just like the Bible says. God, I know that she knows it very well. The B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. I pray that more than ever before in this time, Kylie would live that out, give her the extra strength that she needs
to function in the field that you have called her to. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Appreciate you, Kylie. I think the only other individual that is actually not with us today is Andrew. Is Andrew here? Did I miss him? Okay, Andrew would a lot of times be back here on the drum kit. How many of you appreciate Andrew? Nathanja. So Andrew, you might be watching today or you might be watching at another time. We just want to say that we appreciate you. We're thankful for you. And we're thankful for what the Lord has called Andrew to as well at this specific season in his life. Would you join me in praying over Andrew? Lord, I thank you for Andrew, and I thank you for what you've called him to. And I thank you, Lord, I just thank you for the protection of God that's on his life daily as he does what he's called to do within the educational system, God, doing a part of that, making things possible. I ask that you would watch over him, and I pray that in the season of life that you have him in, that you would just continually speak. I pray the same thing over Andrew, that he is a stellar model of the gospel where he works. That when people, God, Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. I pray that people would look at Andrew and say, that's the direction that I want to go. I pray that you would watch over him. I pray that you would protect him. I pray that you would keep him. God, we thank you today for all of those who make the educational process helpful to us. And I ask that you would be with those that might be watching online that are sitting in another state right now. I pray that you would encourage them in their field as well, particularly in this specific semester that we're in. And we give you the thanks for that in Jesus' name. And everyone shouted this morning, amen. Hey, we've got for the Meramecites kids, I believe we have some of our online families that might attend Meramecites Church that'll be coming. We're doing just a quick parade right after service, and we're going to be blessing all of the kids on campus from zero, from birth through high school. So you will see after service today, there's going to be a little bit of a difference as you walk out. So just be ready for that, and we're thankful for what we're able to do for them. Let's give to the Lord today. We have a couple different ways that you can do that. And let me just explain those quickly. Some of you have been utilizing the boxes. There's one off to your left, a black box. One over here off to my left that you could see. These are giving boxes. So some of you have been putting your tithe and your offering in those. We also have tithing and offering envelopes that are located in those. So you could just go ahead and fill it out and then give, continue to give generously to the Lord. Many are giving online right now. We're thankful for that. You can go to MeramecHeights.com and go to that giving tab. We have a secured link for you to give in. And then we also, if you're mailing your gift in, we have P.O. Box 1205 Arnold, Missouri 63010. We're thankful again for the faithfulness of God. I don't know that there would ever be a week that would go by that I wouldn't want to say that. Who's thankful that the Lord is blessing us in our finances? We really are thankful for that as a local church. And I want you to just continue to be praying, because not everybody's in the same space that we are. And we have looked for ways and have done things to help some local pastors that are going through some challenging times during this time. That's because of your generosity. So I just want to remind you, as you are generous, as we are generous, we can continue to be generous for others. I also want to just give you a little bit of a challenge and a homework assignment. Can you just, when you're driving by churches, even if you don't know the pastor's name, can you just lift that church up before the Lord and say, Lord, can you bless those that have been called to oversee it? Because I want to tell you, pastors right now during this time need your support and your help. I think we're ready to go into the word today, aren't we? Joy has my word right here. She's got my notes. And we're going to jump right into this morning. Go ahead and get your Bibles, and you can turn to the book of Galatians. Can you say Galatians with me? Galatians. Now, we're going to be in this specific book for a while. We're actually excited. Next weekend's going to be a little bit of an off week. That's right. Amen. Amen. It probably would help. Just let me throw this out. It probably would help if you're pulling Wi-Fi right now from the church. It would probably help if you had shut that off, because we might be getting some glitches there. So if you wouldn't mind to go to your, and I know some of you are sharing and things like that, but if you wouldn't mind to just shut your Wi-Fi off for a little bit, that might help us out. get through the day. But thank you for that. Praise the Lord over there. That was good. The Lord has been for some time, and it was really last Sunday afternoon that he really culminated this, as I was doing some organizing in our bedroom. The Lord began to speak, or has been speaking to me, about really navigating through entire Bible. Amen. So we are going to be in Galatians for a while. Next weekend, Jessica Turnbow is going to be speaking what the Lord has put on her heart. So you're going to want to come out and be a part of that. It's going to be a great service, a great time. Other than that, we're going to be diving into Galatians. I'm not saying that we won't have some off weeks where we might go to some other themes, but we're going to walk all the way through those five chapters. So just be ready for that. I want to give you, some people at times can have this mindset or this thought that I'm just not really into the Bible. Can I speak to that as your pastor just for a moment? Yes or no? Okay, I've got to go. You know where I've got to go anyway, but it'd be nice to have some support in the house this morning. If you are the type of person that says, I'm a believer, but I just really can't get in the Bible, I want to say something in love. Something is not right with you spiritually. Well, I really don't like it. It's hard. It's hard for me to listen to sermons. Listen to me this morning. What you need to do is you need to say, Father, I need your help. I need you to open my heart to the word. Another thing that you could do is find a brother or sister in the Lord and say, you know what? This is one thing that I really don't like about my Christian walk with the Lord. I've never really been into the Bible. Would you agree with me this morning? If there's ever a time we need to be into the Bible, it is right now. Right now. Now, we've always needed that, don't get me wrong, but navigating the Word of God is going to be important. So we are in the book of Galatians. I'm going to give you a little backdrop today, and I want to challenge you, dads and moms, get your phone out. You've got some notes there, or write it down this morning. Write some of these things down so that you could take it home and study it out too. Galatians was written by Paul. Now, there's some variables when we start talking about the exact writings of Scripture, but it is believed that Galatians was written around 55 to 56 AD. I've really been walking through some of these things with our kids. We know that BC stands for before Christ. AD, we can look at it as after the death of Christ. Anybody ever have any BC moments in their lives, some before Christ moments? And now you're walking into the after-death moments. In other words, you died in him, so there's a new alignment coming into your life. And I just want to make you aware of what we're talking about. In 55, 56 AD, there was a certain thing that was going on in the church that is very important for us to grasp if we're going to better understand Galatians. Now, a lot of people sometimes have this mindset. Well, I've read Galatians. Matter of fact, most of what I memorized is from Galatians. But sometimes, from the historical vantage point, we don't necessarily know what was happening. I am amazed that as we study the Word of God, that I am seeing right here in 2020, folks, 2020, some of the same stuff that was happening at 55, 56 AD in the church. So when we know it, and it's like, okay, Galatians, let's see. Okay, this was written by Paul. It's about 56, 55 AD. Okay, what was going on historically in the church, even in the world at that time? And you can find, let me say this, you could also, did you know there's also great history to read outside of the Bible? Okay, so we get history not just from the Bible, but there are some great things to read as well. And I'm not going to give you a list of those books today. Paul is addressing specifically in this epistle. An epistle is a letter. It's a letter to the churches of Galatia. And it's very important for me to say that it's a letter to the churches. Paul is addressing, unlike other books, he is addressing a specific group of churches. Now, let me break this down. Galatia was a province. Who's ever heard of South County? yeah, South County is a place. You've got kind of the incorporated part, the unincorporated part. There's even places that we call South County that really aren't South County. We say we're in South County. Maybe not really, though, when you look at what's defined as that. But South County makes up more than just one specific place that was talking about. Think about this. We're in Arnold right now, but we are in Meramec Heights. It's this little area off of Arnold. We have an Arnold mailing address. So when Paul is addressing Galatia, he's not addressing church. He's addressing churches. Everybody say churches. And this writing from Paul will become what's known as a circulating epistle. And how that worked is it would work through churches. So they would read it for a little bit, and it would be passed on to someone else, and they would read it for a little bit, and then they would... Now, I don't know about you. I don't know how many Bibles that I have. I know of another Bible collector in this church. I won't say his name. He might have more than me. But I just love collecting Bibles. Some might be like, well, why are you collecting Bibles? There's people in the world. Well, I don't collect cars, and I don't collect video games, and I stopped collecting baseball cards. So when I find a good Bible, it doesn't... I want that. And I'm also one that will give Bibles away. So that's just something about me. It's something that I enjoy. Paul is writing to this province in which there are several, I'm going to call it towns or jurisdictions in which people live. Matter of fact, Galatia, and if you get your Bible maps out, I'm not providing that for you today, but if you get your Bible maps out, you will see, and as you study this, you will see that Galatia is where a group of people from Gaul have migrated and they have settled. They have settled in different regions in the province of Galatia. They have much the same backgrounds, and within this, Paul is addressing the church. So Galatia is not a city in and of itself. It is a region. Paul is addressing at least these four churches. You can write them down. In this province, in Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey, Paul is addressing at least these four churches. He is addressing to the church of Galatia, Antioch. He's addressing Lystra. He's addressing Iconium. And he's addressing Derbe. So four churches that we're quite sure of. Let me tell you the issue that was in the church or churches of Galatia. Who's ever been in a church that had an issue? So you left the church to find another church so that you could find a church that had no issues. And that church, guess what, church, had an issue. So you left the church because you needed to find another church, right? Because the Bible says to be in unity that had no issues. So you've been in 4, 5, 6, 7, 10, 15 churches in your lifetime because you're trying to find the perfect one. Can I help all of us with that? You are a person who has issues. You break it just as much as I do. We're all in the same boat. Now, are there issues that need to be addressed? Absolutely. That's what the epistles are. The epistles were not this long list of, hey, this is an amazing church. Follow it. Do everything that you see. This is the church that has it all down. No, quite differently. And we have many of those churches that claim that today. Untrue, but have that claim. Looks right, smells right, sounds right. Leaders look good. That doesn't make the church right. And the church shouted amen. There were issues in the church then. There are issues in the church now. And who would agree? Issues have to be dealt with. They have to be talked about, worked through, reconciled under the spirit of unity. Here was the issue. Judaizers, you might want to say Judaizers. I've heard it pronounced a couple different ways. I say Judaizers, had moved into these churches of Galatia, and they had begun to teach their doctrine. I'm going to say it this way for right now, but you'll have to track me through the whole sermon. They began to teach what was their gospel. They were known as legalists. Legalist means this. Legalists will always go back to the what? The law. We need to be in the law. Pastor Brian, you know that we do need to keep the law. Who in here has ever drove over 55 where the speed limit was 55 and you were well over, you broke the law so somebody pulled you over? Were you keeping the law? No. You broke the law. Who is hoping for a ton of grace? Okay. I could go on and on and on. I want to start it by saying this. There has never been and never will be at Meramec Heights Church someone good enough to keep the law. No, not one. If our goal becomes keeping the law, we have to understand that we are trying to walk alongside of Jesus Christ and be a part of what only he could do. Now let me also say this. Pastor, do we need to be doing what's right? Absolutely. Absolutely. So there's a ton to these epistles and ton to the gospels. But what we see is we have this group of legalists that were coming in, Judaizers. They were part of the church. They were mixed within the church. And they were teaching people contrary to what Paul was teaching them. Matter of fact, there were many elements of the law, but the big one to the Galatians church was that of circumcision. And this is how it worked. A lot of people might think that these Judaizers just really didn't have much of it down, or they were anti-God, which is not true. Judaizers in the Galatians church had no problem with believing that you needed faith in Jesus Christ. This is the caveat or the problem. They believed faith in Jesus Christ was important. However, it was also the adherence of the law that allowed you to become saved. And who knows, that doesn't work. That will never fit in the Bible. Jesus came to fulfill a law that no one could fulfill. Only God himself. What happens? He dies on Calvary's cross. The old covenant changes. The veil is rent. And we are in a new place. We're in a new testament. We're in a new era. Who's thankful that we live in the new? So this issue was, I really could have called this whole teaching, because this is what Galatians accompanies or talks about. I really could have called it Jesus plus. And I want to start by saying this. When it comes to salvation, it's Jesus period. There is nothing that you can do. You didn't come to him kind of cleaned up. Like you looked at the law, and I'm not doing the big ones, but I'm about 70% of this thing. You remember the guy in the Bible who said, Jesus, I've done all this stuff. Oh, yeah, I've done that. And he said, okay, sell all your possessions. I can't. Some of us still today live thinking that we're really doing pretty good in keeping the law. I just want to remind you, no, you're not. You couldn't keep it, and you've broken it. And Scripture says if you've broken part of it, you've broken the whole thing. Go look at the Ten Commandments. You broke it all. So we like to tier things. God is saying if you broke one of it, you broke all of it. If our access to salvation is through trying to be good enough, it is automatically broken. So the issue is these Judaizers are teaching Jesus plus the law, especially around circumcision. I want to say this. Anytime we try to complete salvation by adding anything to it other than Jesus dying on the cross for our sins, we get in trouble very quickly. And we not only, I've said this many times, we not only get ourselves in a conundrum where our vantage point of our salvation is this ebb and flow of I'm in it, I'm out of it, I'm in it, out, I'm out of it. That's not what Christ wanted for your life. It's not his plan for your life. Any process other than grace through faith in Jesus Christ is teaching outside of the gospel. It is a counter gospel. It is a sub gospel. Paul will show us it's not a gospel at all. A person has never been and never will be saved by doing good enough. That's why you might have a friend and you're like, I would bring him to church, but you know, Pastor. I'm like, bring him. Well, Pastor, I mean, they're really out there. Can you please go back 20 years? Go back to the way you used to act, the way you used to think, the way you used to treat people. You don't clean them up and then say, I think you're about ready to receive this. Now you understand some of Hebrews or Galatians. No, the whole fact is, no, sir, you're right. I couldn't do it. You can't do it. We just have to accept it. It is by grace through faith. Let me also say this. This is where it really gets tricky. You don't stay saved by keeping the law either. Let's really try to help Jesus with our salvation by saying, Lord, I did pretty good this week keeping the law. You didn't keep the law. He kept the law. Do we need to move to places of spiritual maturity in our life? Well, yes, because that's what believers do. If Christ has changed you, there is a switch in your desire. The enemy tries to pull you back in the old. That's what I said we've got to get into the Bible for, because if you spend time in this, you are going to see your heart sensitive to the things written in it. That's why you give me, let me get onto the men here for a minute. That's why guys will study stats on a lot of different things. You can ask them stuff and they know it. I am amazed by some of the things that guys here, even in the church, know. But watch this. That same man that says, well, I never could really get into the Bible, this is the most important thing that you could get into. So when I say, okay, Lord, this is the day that things shift in my life. Day one, you begin to read it, nothing happens. Well, what happened when you were working out on the car in the garage that you bought 25 years ago? And you'll think, did you walk in and the wife says, that 357 sounds, or 350 sounds amazing. You've been working on it 10 years. I haven't heard anything yet. But you keep tinkering and spending money and maybe talking, hey, it's only going to be $200 more. I need to get the carburetor dip. I need chrome on this thing. But it doesn't even run yet. But you've been tinkering, reading manuals, YouTube. What would happen if you would get in the Word? Watch this. Day one, nothing changes. You ready, men of God? Day 14, nothing changes. Day 30, nothing changes. Still bored with it? God, I'm coming to you. Start marking it up. Write in it. Write things like, God, I'm really struggling with even obeying this. If your wife finds it, she'll appreciate the fact that you're being honest. And you move from flirting with him on Sunday to getting in a relationship. 6 months goes by. I'm feeling like I'm getting it. Like if I don't do it, I kind of start feeling a little hungry for it. A year goes by. There will be a time, if you will stay with it, you will look back on your life and say, God, how could I live without it? I want more of this than anything else in my life that has been of value that I put more importantly. So it doesn't just like jump. It takes time. And I say that because it is the men of God in Meramecites Church that are called to lead their families. And if the men of God, the dads, the grandpas, the uncles, are not in this book and reading it, and that does not mean it is a perfect model. I know it's not for me, but it means that we're pushing that out to our family. The beauty of what is to come as we start walking through tension and stuff for our kids to go back to a book that mom and dad lived out. Amen? You don't become saved by keeping the law. You don't keep salvation by keeping the law. The other issue about what was going on in the church of Galatia is that these Judaizers had discounted Paul's authority as an apostle, or we could even say as a church leader. And as you read, it's really fascinating. And if you read through these lens, matter of fact, some of it had discredited his apostolic office, minimizing his calling, especially if you get into some of the historical things written around this time that were great writings. They weren't Bible. They were never canonized. But it's amazing the rap that they gave Paul. He was considered a second-rate apostle to Peter and James. Think about Paul. There would not be anybody in the church today that would have guts when we get to heaven to walk up to the Apostle Paul and say, you were second rate to Peter and James, but I'm thankful that you made it. Right? These Judaizers had discounted or discredited him. And I'm getting ready to talk to you here in a few moments about what you should do when you are discounted and discredited. in the call that the Lord has put on your life. Because if you're a called man or woman to lead a family, to lead a church, to lead a business, to lead a community, somebody will come and try at some point to discount the call that God has put on your life. It's going to be part of it. Paul walked through it, so will you. Thank you. They believed, these individuals believed that Paul was actually discounting truth and was working to gain a large following of Gentile believers, like trying to build a church. Okay, this is what the thought of the Judaizers were. And part of this we can kind of see because Paul comes out of this experience of highly persecuting Christians. Now he's writing letters to them. So there's some tension we have to live with and try to understand here. Let me say this before we get into Galatians 1:1. And we'll get out of here on time today. So don't worry about it. We're in a series, so I can kind of shut this off at any time. Let me say it this way before we jump into Galatians 1:1. Jesus did not need help from man to fulfill the standard of the law. He didn't need it in Bible times. He doesn't need it now. Jesus does not need your help to fulfill only the standard that he could provide. And Galatians is a book to several churches that falls on the ear of Meramecites Church today because Paul is going to show us that it is our freedom in Christ that makes us strong, not our adherence to a list of 10 to 500, 600 plus things that have been added by man. Amen. Through history. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. Do we have that in the back, guys? We've got Galatians 1, 1. I can read it here on my book. My book, the Bible. I can read it from the Bible here. It's not just my book, it's God's book. So I apologize. I said that wrong. We got it? Okay, let's go here. I think this will be a little bit easier for me. Galatians 1:1 says this. You remember what we talked about? The second-rate apostle has something to say in his letter. Okay? Paul, an apostle, not from men, nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. We're going to leave it right there at Galatians 1:1. I mean, when I look at this, this is a pretty good credential. What do you think, guys? He is saying, I'm an apostle, not from men nor through man. Pastors will carry a license. They'll carry an ordination. Paul is saying, man has not done this. But through Jesus and God the Father, and he is reminding us that it was God the Father who raised Jesus from the dead. So Paul is saying to those who were saying that he was a second-rate apostle or believer or whatever you want to call it, he was saying the credential that I carry comes from God. I want to speak to you a moment about paperwork. Because some in the room would say this, paperwork is not needed. The diploma, not needed. The degree, not needed. Well, I would argue that. I would say it could be needed. Now, some of you are like, no, I mean, look at people like you got Gates and you've got all these people that built these robust companies. Oh, they had paperwork. It might have been different than a high school diploma and a bunch of degrees, masters of this, doctors of this. They had paperwork. I said it just a few weeks ago. It might have been the paperwork of the School of Hard Knocks. Losing $5 million here. $17 million here, starting something up, getting fired from the thing you created. They had scars, they had wounds. But I want to speak to this for just a moment. Some of us say, well, the paperwork isn't needed. If you are going in for heart surgery on Thursday, who would say paperwork is needed for that physician? Not, well, yeah, I kind of watched it on YouTube. You just kind of lift this over here. No, paperwork. Where did they go to school? Or what most of us would do, hey, how many of these surgeries have done? Hey, Dad, that was Dad's heart doctor. So, I mean, he had a pretty good experience. You see what I'm saying? So there are times and there are places that God will use where he told you or what he would tell you to do with a level of paperwork that will get you in the door to speak to people that you would not have spoke to without the paperwork. Let me also say this. God can always, always override paperwork anytime he decides. So sometimes you will be speaking to people that have greater paperwork than you. And you're like, God, how did that happen? He's like, I just worked this one out. Paperwork, a teacher, paperwork. There's been some training. There's been a, you know, I mean, I look at myself. I'm just talking about me right now. So just watch, look here. I would not want to teach my kids calculus because I would be doing good to spell it, right? But I got some people that I know that could. And many of them that could teach it at a high level have some paperwork that they went through, a degree that they achieved, that I'm like, well, I'm comfortable with you doing this. We will always have people, situations that just, I mean, you just, how did they get so smart? I'm saying this because I have learned this in my own life. We have to know what the Lord has called us to. I personally have no desire to go grab a doctorate of theology or a master's of theology. I do have a desire to keep teaching the word of God with a whole heart, with the heartbeat of the gospel. So to do that, schooling for me will be required my entire life in some way. Paperwork. Here's the deal. Paul is showing them an authority that they've been called on, but he's also been discounted. And I feel like there could be some people watching online or even sitting in this service today, and you have felt discounted, so you gave up. A discount might be you're going in exactly the right direction. So maybe somebody, whatever you want to put on it, somebody won't give you room for this or room for that. Keep training. Keep studying. Keep looking. Paul is laying out the credentials, and he is saying, hey, it's the Lord Jesus and the Father that has called this to me. I mean, it's a pretty good lineup of somebody who to authenticate your ministry. Jesus and God are pretty up there. And he said, these are the ones who have called me to this thing. Matter of fact, you'll remember how he was called, right? He wasn't called on Sunday morning in church. I'm not saying this in a bad way, but he wasn't called at church camp with 700 other believers. He wasn't called on women's retreat. He was knocked off his horse on the road to Damascus, blinded, and then said, I need to send you to Gamaliel. I need to send you to a real mentor of this thing so you can learn. The scales will later fall off his eyes, but he goes, I believe that Paul went through a master's of divinity like that. When you study it, it took some time, but he listened to God and God got him there. And I want to encourage you to do the same thing. Paperwork will come in a variety of different ways. I get that. I am not saying everybody needs to go get a degree. That's not what I'm saying. I am saying you need to be well studied in what God has called you to do. Go after it. Train hard. Don't give up because it didn't maybe work the way that you thought. Keep going after that. Let's look at, do we have Galatians 2? Let's look at Galatians 2. And it says, Paul also says this. He says, and all the brethren who were with me, and then it goes to the churches, not church, to the churches of Galatia. He is saying, I'm not second rate to them. I was called this way. Matter of fact, all of my brothers have been called out by God for this specific task. Write this down in your notes today. Just know who has called you. And when nobody else believes in you, go back to your paperwork right here. Know who has called you. When it seems like this isn't happening or that isn't happening, it's taking so long, or you're at the family reunion, at the family gathering, and you're trying to lay out something that you learned here from Galatians chapter 1, and people are like, who in the world is he? You know, do you remember what you were doing 10 years ago or 5 years ago or a year ago? You're like, well, I got knocked off my horse and God called me into this thing. Just continue to know who has called you. I believe in the body of Christ. We have too many people that kind of fluctuate from this to that because they forget, wait a minute, God told me to do this. God told me to go after this. Galatians chapter 1, verse 3. Galatians chapter 1, verse 3. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to read this again. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now we hear this, and it might be similar to somebody, maybe we're leaving the church parking lot or something, somebody, hey man, have a blessed week. We're like, hey, thank you, you have a blessed week too. My week's going to be a blessing. He just said have a blessed week. We might understand that. Other churches, they never say have a blessed week where I'm at. That's fine. This greeting is highly, I'm going to say theological and doctrinal, because watch this. Paul says, grace to you. What do you think one of the number one thing the church of Galatia needs? Grace. And a reminder of grace, and a reminder of grace, and a reminder of grace, and a reminder of grace. Paul did not say, peace and grace I leave you. Because I want to tell you this morning, if you have not found grace, you will never know peace. Some of us are trying to find things out of order. How do I have peace about this? How do I have peace about this? How do I have peace? God said he wants to give me a heart and a mind, peace that passes all understanding. Then you start studying his book and it says, well, I didn't want to do that for you. But if I understand grace and God's grace, it's the forefront of how Christianity was built through the death on the cross, then I can also live at peace. So I love the way that Paul will come out and say, grace to you and peace from God the Father and of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me also say, and I don't know if you've ever been in this environment before, Paul is getting ready to bring what I will call a boatload of correction. Who's ever had to bring correction and you were not overly excited about it? Some of you are like, correct, bring it. I want to correct some people. Well, there's a Bible for you. If that's your first deal, go get in here. Paul's getting ready to bring correction. Now, I'm not saying Paul's nervous about it. I mean, this man will go out and wreck ships to build churches. I don't know exactly what he's going through, but I do see this being something that we need to understand in our life, what's getting ready to happen, because Paul rolls it out, whatever his personality type is. He's coming to them and saying, grace and peace to you. And he is reminding them that everything that they're saying, holding on to Jesus plus law, he is going to continue to write in the letter. He is not being swayed by their vantage point of him. And I will say this, if there is ever a time that we're going to have to stand up and lead strong in a plethora of opinion, it is today. You have got to get with God. You have got to spend time with God. You have got to not allow your mind and heart to be bombarded by all the stuff that's out here. You have to take into account some of the things that are out here. You've got to hear from God, and for your family, you have to lead, sir. How many of you know for your churches, you have to lead? For your communities, you have to lead. Paul is bringing groups of people into an alignment, getting ready to, and he starts by saying this, hey, grace and peace to you all, because grace and peace is exactly the heartbeat of Galatians. Paul is reminding them of this really important theme that their lives have been built on, and he's getting ready to bring a level of correction. Let's look at verse 4, Galatians chapter 1, verse 4. Can we go back to 3, Ty, and let me just go from 3 to 4. So grace to you and peace from God the Father and of our Lord Jesus Christ, verse 4, who gave himself for our sins. He's attached grace, who gave himself for our sins, that he might, somebody say, he might deliver us from this present evil age. Did you know that it is not your responsibility to deliver yourself from the presence of this evil age? That presence evil age, if you break it down and study it, evil, present evil age is the order of the world. I could say this in prophetic, the new world order. The order of the world. The function of the world. Not your opinion of how the world functions. The way that the world functions. How does culture outside of Christ function? He is saying, God's come, he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of, whose will? According to what I think, on what day are we on? The what of? 30th. The 30th. Here, August 30th, what Brian thinks and what should be added. No, according to the will of our God and Father. Who is ready to do the will of the Father? Amen. Okay. The only way that we can know the will of God is to study the Word of God. So he lays out a principle in every situation. The only way that we can know the will of God is to study the Word of God. What is my family going through? Well, I want to know the will of God. Well, here's the deal. Don't knee-jerk and go figure out your own thing and then try to make it be the will of God. Okay, Lord, we're kind of in a situation right now where we need a lot of wisdom. I'm going to find the will of God by getting into the Word of God, and he's going to actually guide me, and he's going to actually show me. I'm trying to think of this week how many times I've had to consult the will of God over my own thoughts. I'm not going to get into this, but what things look like Friday for Jefferson County and what I thought was going to roll out Monday, and now what's going to roll out? I'm like, okay, God, you have a will, you have a plan in all of this. What am I supposed to do? And the Lord just to this. Amen. Keep coming back to this. Just keep coming back to my word. I'm going to show you. I'm going to instruct you. Who's thankful for the book of Galatians? Amen. Galatians 1, verse 4 and 5. Who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil age. I just want to release you from trying to deliver you from yourself and from the evil around you. Things that you will do. I'm not saying don't be smart and use your head at all. Get in the word. It'll show you that. There are some practical things that we can even be doing right now as a people. But I'm saying this, it is his power to deliver me. So when it really comes down to it, and let me say this in love, we right now in society are in a hiccup. Let me say this in love, no fear attached. It's going to get worse in a better way. So if we can't get through the hangnail, we can't get through the big idea stuff. That when it gets a little bit tighter and harder and a little bit more pressure, I'm not saying, Lord, how do I man up and figure out how to live? And I'm saying, can you deliver me from this present age? Like, God, I'm not going to put no bicep toward it. I'm just trusting you. I'm trusting you, God, wholeheartedly trusting you. The grace that the Father has set up for the church of Galatia has been set up by him for success. And Paul is just saying, hey, he's the one that's going to deliver you from this present evil. And then he goes on to say, let's go to verse 5. To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. The last verse talked about the Father. He is speaking to the Father, having glory forever and ever and ever. Amen. Regardless of what happens 10,000 years from now, who knows that God's going to receive honor and glory? 100,000 years from now. We can't really think that way, but God's going to receive the glory. 4,000 years prior to us showing up, God receives the glory. 2020 pandemic, God receives the glory. How we're schooling our kids right now, God receives the glory. How we've been doing church for how many weeks now? 12, 14, I don't know. More than that, probably. God receives the glory. How we navigate through these times. Let's see, Lord, what did you say? You said to do this. You said to do this. Okay. Love my neighbor as myself. Okay, I got to get over here, and I got to go ahead and do this. And, oh, I got to walk in the Spirit so I don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Lord, what are things I need to come into alignment with? God receives the glory. Amen. Through everything that we're going through. And Paul is, not only today, but Paul is instructing this church, these churches, that God is going to receive the glory. Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. I marvel. Anybody ever watch any Marvel movies? Okay, I'm just asking. This is, if I can put it in modern day terms, because most of you aren't walking around the house saying, I marvel at your test scores. Most of you. This is another way of saying it. Paul is saying, I am shocked. I marvel that you are turning away so soon. It could be sermon in and of itself. We sing, soon and very soon, we are going to see the... Why haven't we been singing that since I was in Sunday school? I'm 47. Soon and very soon, we are gone. Another decade goes by, I'm 57. Because soon to you and soon to God is two different things. Folks, you are a blip on the map that God created for his glory. Soon and very soon. Do you know when Jesus is ascending, he is going into the heavenlies, and they are standing there marveling, shocked, and astonished. Do you know if that hymn would have been written, it could have been placed right there too? Soon and very soon. We are going to see Christ soon, church. In the grand scheme of things, we kind of put it on a placard between here and here. If I get 87, 92, 105 years, but that's still very minimal to the nearness of God coming and receiving us. Paul is saying, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you into the grace. Grace of what? Grace of Christ. Now watch this. He that hath ears to hear. We would say, oh yeah, that's back then. No, this is right now. I marvel. I am shocked at the many forks of doctrine and theology that people have. That have Gnosticism in them. That have pride and arrogance in them, that have anti-God mentalities, spirits and stuff. And I am shocked by how quickly we turn away from the grace that is the most important thing that binds us to the Father in salvation. I am shocked by whom we make the big deal of this gospel. And Paul is trying to reel them back in and say, Church of Galatians, stop. Stop. He says, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. I'm going to say this. I'm going to say it in love. I'm going to say it online. Everything on YouTube is not true. If your theology and doctrine is being built off 35 different teachers on YouTube, I'm going to tell you right now, you have a squirrely doctrine. But you've got to dig, and you've got to know, and you've got to get back to it, and you've got to say, wait a minute, where have I fallen from the grace in the sense that I'm trying to do this through a line of, I've talked to you about it before, I'm amazed at sermons that we can watch now, where the Word of God isn't even really spoken of, or it's so far in the background. And I'm going to say it in love again today. God wants more for your life than Sunday, than three steps to finding a better you. Or how you can have more of what you want. And if you don't get it, somehow you... No. He's going to give and he's going to take away, and blessed be his name in all of it. There's going to be things that we walk through that we don't understand, that people are watching, our family. And you know what? God, blessed be your name. Paul's like, I'm marveling that you are turning away so soon from him who called you into the grace of Christ to a different gospel. This different gospel, as you study it, goes back to itching ears, where people will be going, I know it's wild. We thought we would never get there. People would have itching ears. People would walk into situations and say, unless you do this, or unless you teach this, this is what's going to happen. My friends, we are in that hour. Well, if you don't do this, this is what we're going to do. Folks, I'm just going to tell you right now, I'm just going to continue to teach this with a loving heart, sitting under spiritual leadership, because we have a church board, and I'm going to speak the Word of God. But I, as Paul, cannot be as swayed by all the stuff going on. Paul's like, I marvel. And I got to say, I join Paul in that, even myself, I marvel by where the church is with all the resources that we have. That we just walk away from the gospel of Jesus Christ and we turn to a different gospel. Let's go to verse 7 and we're going to end here this morning. Which is not another. So I want to say this as I'm closing this morning. There is only one gospel. So when we hear another gospel, it is a counterfeit gospel. Legalists have embedded the church in Galatia. Judaizers are standing up and saying, Jesus, faith in Jesus, that's needed. But you must be circumcised. Because it was away from the changing of a testament. It was hard to be brought up, but we've done so much. I've worked so hard, and think about this, worked so hard, but none of them ever fulfilled it. And they want to go back to somebody else. Say, no, come here. Jesus' law, leave today, remember, think of that. Jesus' law, say it back. Jesus' law, yeah, Jesus' law, yeah, yeah. Jesus' circumcision, that's right. Have you been circumcised? Well, then you can't truly be saved. Well, who knows that regardless of physical circumcision, who knows the heart of every believer has been circumcised? Flesh has been cut away. If you've been circumcised in the Christian thought, it was fulfilled on the cross. If I come to him, he's saying, yeah, we can cut all that flesh away. But Lord, I don't like the way that I think. Well, cut all that flesh away. That's cut off. We don't need that. But Lord, I struggle because I want to be at a place that I'm not. Hey, you remember that second rate apostle they talked about? Read some of his writings. I want to do what's right, but I find myself sometimes doing what's wrong. So I'm gonna hightail it back to the law, right? And when I get back here, I don't remember what it said. What were those 10 things back in Exodus somewhere and all the add-ons? And then I try to match it up and I do good for a while. And then down the road, I'm running back to the law to try to fulfill what I never could. So I am here to remind you today, we'll work all the way through it. It is for freedom that Christ has set you free. You don't have to run back to the law or the things of it. Pastor Brian, what do I have to do? Give me something to work with. You're a Christian. Follow Christ. the Holy Spirit is going to show you. When you begin to step into an area that is off limits, the Holy Spirit will show you. What you do with that is up to you. He will show you. For by grace are you saved. What's this, Ephesians somewhere? It is not this list of works, lest any man would what? Would boast. It's because of Christ. Just a few verses in today. Why don't you bow your hearts with me this morning? Father, thank you for the teaching of your word. Thank you for the first 7 verses of Galatians. God, we really don't want to defect from grace. We really don't want to try to create this thought or construct this model of what has already been fulfilled in you. We want to know this week that you have fulfilled the works of the law, and now we want to do our part to live by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. As you have defeated every sin in front of us, we just have to walk in that and trust you, God. I thank you for our salvation today. I thank you that it's completed in you. I thank you that it is not Jesus plus works. It's Jesus, period. And then, Father, we are sanctified and we are justified and we come into this relationship with you that matures. I thank you that every believer in this room and watching online can mature in you. No matter how far off they are, I thank you that you could create a desire in them to mature and to grow up in you. I pray for wherever we are in this message that I taught today. I pray that you would speak deeply to our hearts. I pray that it would challenge us. And I pray that we would do something with it. I ask these things this morning in your name. And everyone said this morning, amen. Let me give just real.